Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tom Compass. I'm the director of the Crawford School of Public Policy, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here this afternoon to this special event, this special lecture. Before we begin, let me take a moment to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land that we meet on and pay respects to their elders, past and present. I'm going to introduce the acting vice chancellor in a minute, who will introduce our special guest speaker. Before I do that, let me just take a minute to personally thank Your Excellency for coming here today back to ANU. Gordon, if I might. Gordon was a student in what was called the National Center for Development Studies back in 2001, which has now become the Crawford School of Public Policy. So I am unabashedly proud to call you one of my alumni, and so very happy to have you here. Very straightforward format. After the address by His Excellency, he's offered to answer a few questions, if that's okay. Good. And then there's a special alumni reception afterwards in the Headley Bull Center. So to get started, please let me introduce the acting vice chancellor and the Deputy Vice Chancellor of Research, Professor Margaret Hardy. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Your Excellency, Madam Lilo, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's really an enormous pleasure to be here today and have the opportunity to welcome a very esteemed ANU alumnus back to speak to and meet with you today here. At ANU, as many of you will be aware, we often talk of the leadership positions that many graduates move to after they leave here. We value and really admire and look to the contributions of our alumni all over the world, and you are great ambassadors for the quality of the education and the experience we give you here at the ANU here. And it's really an enormous pleasure to see the great contribution of so many of our alumni in the world at large to their home nations. And Prime Minister Lilo, of course, could hardly be, you know, a better example of the type of alumnus that we are proud of and we showcase representing the Australian National University. Tom has already alluded to some of his history and association with the ANU. But after graduating in 2000 with a Master of Development and Administration from what is now the Crawford School of Economics and Government, Mr. Lilo was elected to the National Parliament of the Solomon Islands in 2001. Dedicated to strengthening his country's economy, Mr. Lilo had a paper published through the ANU Asia Pacific Press that was entitled Hard Times Ahead: Issues and Reform in Solomon Islands Public Finance, which was presented at the Pacific Updates on Solomon Islands, Fiji and Vanuatu in June 2000. In the 10 years following that time, he has served in a number of key roles, including the Minister for Finance, Minister for Justice and Legal Affairs, Minister for Environment and Conservation. And prior to his election as Prime Minister last year, he served again as the Minister for Finance and Treasury. It's an honour to have him return to the University today to discuss the future of the Solomon Islands economy. And please join me in welcoming the Honourable Gordon Lilo.
Thank you, Acting Vice Chancellor, for those remarks. I'd like to join Professor Tom Compass also to acknowledge and recognize the indigenous owners of this land, and in particular for giving a space for the Australian National University to be built on this land. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, first allow me to say how delighted I am to visit parts of this beautiful country in the last 3 days at the invitation of the Australian government. It has been a busy schedule, but I'm delighted that the Australian National University is also part of this visit. ANU is not new to me, and it is indeed a privilege to come back to my alma mater, I still have some fond memories of this place. But this afternoon, as the Prime Minister of Solomon Islands, it is an honor to address such a distinguished audience in such an esteemed institution. As you know, the ANU has over the years ably educated many students in the Asia-Pacific region who have gone on to play important roles in their countries and the region at large. And it is a privilege to be part of that expanding group of people who continue to shape public policy and thinking in the region. It is therefore only appropriate that I take this opportunity to say how appreciative I am of this esteemed institution. But for this afternoon's address, I wish to talk a little bit about my country, Solomon Islands, and highlight some of the challenges that we face and the attempt to address these as we move forward in the future. Some of these challenges are common, even universal, but from my observation, the solutions that are grounded in local context and are detailed are more sustainable. And a suitable title for my paper then is Common Challenges, Unique Solution. Ladies and gentlemen, first let me paint a picture of Solomon Islands to give context to my talk. Solomon Islands gained political independence from Great Britain in 1978, some 34 years ago. And when the state was formally established, the stage was, however, already crowded with clans, tribes, language groupings, and other constituents. Many of these are semi-autonomous groups exercising their own rules and authority over their territories and constituents. And since then, the state has attempted to exert positive control over these groups with mixed success. The emerging country became what the late Prime Minister of Solomon Islands, Solomon Mamaloni, described as a nation conceived but never born. This remains a fundamental character of Solomon Islands at independence, as it is today and will be in the foreseeable future. But in the 1990s, the term arc of instability entered the political discourse, referring essentially to weak states that are unable to control their affairs and that are at risk of terrorist influence or penetration. And although the terminology describing the situation may have changed, the fundamental reality remains Mamaloni's in the notion described by late Mamaloni as the unborn state. In the above situation, state legitimacy, national consciousness, national solidarity, and even political direction become difficult to achieve. Second, the Solomon Islands economic base remains narrow today. Just as Charles Woodford observed in 1893, before the islands were declared a British protectorate. Mr. Woodford thought then that plantations would form the mainstay of the economy, and consequently, plantations were developed. Indeed, today, the Solomon Islands supports one of the biggest plantation estates in the region. The estates were formerly owned by Lilo's brothers, but have now been sold to the Russell Islands Plantation Estate Limited. And in the late 1980s and early 1990s, the economy turned to logging for its economic base. Mr. Woodford would have been quite surprised. Logging became popular because of easy access to cash often brought in by Asian loggers. The low capital outlay and the quick return on investment, if you can describe logging as an investment, made it a lucrative choice, not only for the entrepreneurs, but their local promoters and partners. Succeeding governments have attempted to diversify into agriculture, mining, fisheries, and manufacturing. But to this day, logging is still a major contributor to the country's export earnings. Ladies and gentlemen, I mention one more aspect of the Solomon Islands as a background, and that is the misfit between the introduced Westminster system of government administration and those that existed in Solomon Islands. Contestation exists between formal institutions and informal institutions and between the power structures of these institutions. Professor Corinne Kerr described this as akin to fitting a square peg into a hole or a round hole. I paint that background not to justify any failures or shortcomings on the part of any institution, but to understand the reasons for our challenges to date. More importantly, such realities will continue to be relevant as we define and craft public policy in response to current challenges. In 1998, as many of you know, Solomon has descended into a social unrest in what is now commonly called the ethnic tension. Thanks to Prime Minister Howard and the Pacific Island Forum then, in 2003, the Regional Assistance Mission to Solomon Islands, or RAMSI for short, was assembled, sent to Solomon Islands, and as they say, the rest was history. But since RAMSI's intervention, law and order had returned, and the country was being rebuilt. Next year, 2013, RAMSI will mark its 10th anniversary. But more importantly, the intervention force will be drastically scaled down. Bearing in mind that although institutional capacity had been restored, the context in 2003 remains somewhat the same in terms of the economic challenges. The RAMSI transition must be managed responsibly to ensure sustainability of peace. Issues such as youth unemployment, absence of economic infrastructure, and institutional leadership remain significant challenges that must inform transitions into, or that must form transition into the post-RAMSI period. And the government's view, which has been consistently expressed, is that transition must be task-bound and not time-bound. This is important to ensure sustainability of peace for Solomon Islands and the region. Ladies and gentlemen, macroeconomic and even fiscal management continues to be a challenge in Solomon Islands. This is not a novel observation. Many observe this, and many attempts of public and institutional reforms have been carried out to varying degrees of success. But the chronic problem lies in weak institutions, processes, and personnel. The mechanism for determining, monitoring, and assessing the use of public funds and resources still remain weak. And to add more difficulty, many of the people tasked to operate these processes lack capacity. Worse still, they too are often tempted to operate the system for their own ends. However, through fiscal policy management, since 2010, the buffer zone for foreign reserves have improved, reducing risks that are due to financial fluctuation affecting the international price of export commodities. The government, with the help of RAMSI, has increased capacity in financial management and monitoring. This tighter control over spending, as well as improvement in revenue collection, will be responsible for some revenue growth into 2012. But improved macroeconomic and fiscal management since 2003 has also provided the impetus to expand the economic base. Currently, several onshore processing fish plants have been established, and some more are in the pipeline. Agricultural development and small-scale manufacturing are also making some progress. Mining also presents a significant prospect, and currently the only operating mine at Gold Ridge continues to generate revenue. But the government is looking at the prospect of developing a large nickel mine on the islands of Isabel and Choiseul, hopefully sooner than later. But recently the courts have cleared the way for the government to make progress in the grant of the mining rights to the developer. And in that regard, it may be worth mentioning that in June this year, the Solomon Islands became a member of the Extractive Industry Transparency Initiative, or the EITI. This is an international framework for reporting mining revenues, and it is a positive step in developing good operational and management structures for the industry based on international best practice. We have learned many lessons from mining countries that have made mistakes, and Solomon Islands must begin the new industry with very high international standards. Let me now touch a little bit on mobilizing of customary land assets for development. The government since independence have talked about mobilizing customary land for development. yet land remained locked under customary tenure. And since May 2012, the government, through the customary land policy management unit, has consulted with traditional landowners about opening up their land for development. The owners of large tracts of land deemed suitable for agriculture, tourism, or other developments are asked to record their land details under the Land Recording Act. We have identified areas in Malaita, Gordo Canal in the Western Province for this initiative. And I'm pleased to say that responses to this program have been positive, and it is hoped that in the later half of the year, proactive land recording programs will commence in the selected provinces. Following this, investors can be invited to assess the feasibility of these land blocks for their investment. But the weak leadership of customary landowner groups need to be strengthened to ensure that they speak with one voice. This, it is hoped, will create certainty and predictability for the investor. Ladies and gentlemen, it is also fair to say that political parties in the Solomon Islands are only active during general election periods. After that, they remain dormant again till the next election. Weak political parties led to what has been termed locally as grasshoppering, which denotes crossing the floor of parliaments by parliamentarians without regard to political ideology. In response to that, the government has funded national consultations to examine structures and processes of improving political stability and integrity. Provincial consultations in the provinces had been made, and a national convention had taken place in July this year, which brought together eminent leaders from the region and the leaders of the country. The report and recommendations are now before Cabinet, and soon a decision will be made on the implementation of some of these recommendations. It is hoped that these measures will create the institutional environment for political stability and integrity. With regards to improving the electoral process, some progress has also been made towards a new voter registration for 2014 general election. Recruitment and training of personnel, establishment of provincial operation offices, voter registration centres, and equipping them have now begun after the recent by-elections for our two constituencies this month. And the new voter registration is expected to be completed in 2013 in preparation for the 2014 general election. There are also some minor legislative amendments that are being prepared, which will improve the electoral process. Ladies and gentlemen, what is also observed in the seeming disconnect between government at the central government and at the provincial or constituency level is a matter of worrying concern to us. And to date, public funding through the current system has not been experienced or witnessed at the community or village level. This reinforces the notion that the government is a foreign institution. And so at present, the government is considering a structure which connects the central government directly with the constituency, the concept that we are working on, a constituency development authority, which we believe will empower and mandate local communities to be able to implement community development and enter into meaningful development within the constituencies. This is also intended to encourage the spirit of enterprise at the constituency level. The experience in the last 3 decades has shown that a system of government closer and meaningful to the local community is desired. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, I believe there is some work to be done towards improving aid coordination. In recent years, international and regional arrangements had been signed to ensure aid effectiveness. In our case, we have launched what we call the National Development Strategy 2011 to 2020. And our development assistance from partners will be based on the priorities outlined in this strategy. Development, we believe that development assistance in Solomon must align itself with the National Development Strategy to achieve the national goals as outlined in that document. So, ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, I will say this, that the Solomon Islands continue to face many challenges. But despite this, the country is determined to deal with the issues and create a viable future for tomorrow's generation. Some of the challenges are common to all, and for regional, we believe that we can depend on the bilateral and multilateral efforts so that we can inform, have a well-informed solutions that are based on the local context and the detail of which we can work out through such a consultation with our local communities. Once again, allow me to thank the Australian National University for giving me this opportunity to share with you some of the challenges that Solomon Islands face and also our vision and plans to move forward into the future. I also wanted to thank the Government of Australia for organizing this official visit and making it possible for me to make this lecture here at the University. So, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you all for listening.
So, as agreed, the Prime Minister is happy to take some questions from the audience for about 15 or so, 20 minutes.
Yes.
In the back.
Prime Minister, John Blaxland here from the ANU here. Thank you for an excellent presentation, and it's a great honour to have you with us. I'm wondering, your views on Ramsey. Ramsey has, you acknowledged, played a significant contribution over the last 10 years. What's changed that you now feel confident that you can do without
it? Well, I think we have been able to build a good, positive train and engagement within our own, society. For instance, we would say that law and order is an important aspect or factor in building up a stable society. You would see that over the past 10 years, since the engagement of Ramsey, we have been able to see a good development of our society moving together, more integrated. And one event that I think would attest to that is the recent Festival of Pacific Arts. I could not go any other period beyond that than the Festival of Pacific Arts, in which we have minimal resources exerted by the police force. They had basically no military on the street, but that we have been able to have locals running the street, ensuring that we don't have any other, sorry to say, the ning-nongs around the street, to cause disturbances. And I must say that, we've been able to have a trouble-free festival. You wouldn't be able to have that some 10 years ago. Or even post the conflict, you would still have to have slight incidents of social disturbance. We didn't have one at all, except that there was a little boy who was so hungry, went to the stall and said, look, can I have that food? But then they didn't respond to him, so he decided to help himself. But that was for him from a little boy, for a very good purpose. He was so hungry. So that, I believe, could attest to the fact that, there is, a good integration of the society.
Satish.
Yes. I don't have the right numbers with me, but obviously the projection so far is that by 2015, logging would decline. It would decline, but for the moment, it has been, we would say, about 60-70% of the whole capacity of the economy, the taxable capacity of the economy has been generated out of logging. And we are so mindful about that. I made a point about moving into mining, which is, you've got to find a way, to transition the economy. There is no other better way to do it than this. But at the same time, we need to get into something more sustainable development, like, for instance, tourism, encouraging more development into the fisheries sector. And I might say this, that you will find that, you know, one of the first countries that has taken strong action in ensuring that we get maximum benefits out of the tuna industry, Solomon Islands, under this vessel day scheme. We've actually stopped, you know, the operation last year, put out on tender the vessel day, you know, provision, you know, for the country, and had been able to fetch a good price for it. In fact, I can't just remember out of my memory, but I think it was something like the around about 5,000 US per vessel day. And we have been going around the world telling them that, you know, this is the best ocean resource management strategy that, you know, we can do to the Pacific Island countries. This came out of the parties to the Nauru Agreement. My real worry is that, you know, there are some members of the parties to the Nauru Agreement that are not taking, you know, tough and serious action in pursuing the vessel day scheme. It's a simple economic concept on ensuring that here's the resources that we have, but because of the international law of the sea, it's a migratory species, yeah, that you cannot, you don't have, you know, the exclusive rights to price the tuna, but we can do it through this vessel day scheme arrangement, which I myself, technically, I it slipped out of my mind how it works, but there is a formula that it is based on. But it works very well. I mean, what it means is that, you know, we have ended up with this scheme that has enabled us to be able to take control of the pricing of that very valuable resources, which for the last 40 years, we have paid little regard to it, neglected it. It should be the main driver for economic growth for the Pacific Island countries, it was never. Instead, we have concentrated on other issues and have ended up missing, you know, the very sector that is generating growth throughout Asia and Europe. I was a bit worried about, you know, the recent indication from the European Union that they want us to drop the vessel day scheme. And if we are going to do that, we basically just have to ended up, you know, pulling back, you know, the fate of the small economies in the Pacific Islands. Good to see you again.
Good to see you, yeah. Just a couple of very quick questions. One, if perhaps you could say a little bit more about your government's plans around political decentralization and where the debate around federalism stands and where it might go. That's the first question. And the second question really related to what you were saying about mining and the move towards becoming a mining economy. I was wondering what the lessons are that you might draw from PNG in relation to avoiding some of the problems that you spoke about earlier on in relation to mining.
One thing, deal with the political or the decentralization issue. At the moment, we are now into about fifth draft of our federal constitution. It's fifth draft. But, you know, some people say that, may say some negative thing about that, but, you know, as far as we are concerned, we have never negotiated a constitution in the past. We basically went and took a ready-made constitution. So perhaps it's a good time for us, you know, to get engaged, get the country and the people involved in the whole process of making their own constitution, making their own constitution. We are now up to the, we have established the Constitutional Congress. Drafts have been circulated and to all the provinces. We are yet to get a feedback from all the provinces, and we would call on the experts now, you know, in constitutional law and other relevant experts, you know, to look into how it will shape out, and the whole format of the drafting. But what it means is that it still remains an issue of of absolute priority to the country, where people still have a popular view that, and it's a popular view, that we should move into a federal kind of setting of government, which is state government and a federal parliament. But at the same time, we want to ensure that the mechanism in making the machinery to work must be feasible, must be feasible for the country. And I don't want to go through in saying what would be the outcome of the Constitutional Congress, because that is a body that has to be respected. But as it stands right now, there are key indicators that we need to point to. And one is that the popular view that, you know, we need to move into state government system, that still stands. Secondly, whether or not that system would be feasible for the country, and that we will not go down the path that it will affect, you know, the economy and the unity of the country. So that's where we are at the moment on that. On the mining thing, yes. I mean, in terms of proximity, logically, we would be looking at Papua New Guinea, and that's exactly what we are doing right now, talking to Papua New Guinea. We have learned that Papua New Guinea, for instance, you know, have moved into establishing a sovereign fund where resources, windfall resources, you know, from the mining sector can be, you know, invested for future generation to help, you know, and sustain, you know, future operation of the economy. And that is exactly the mode of fiscal operation that we are doing right now. We have changed from a basically, you know, cleaning up the basket system of budgeting to, we have worked out a fiscal buffer in our budget where this is where we begin to pick resources out, you know, and put into the budget annually. So in our budget system, you know, we have arrived at a strategy that, say, for instance, you know, this year we have agreed that we will make sure that, you know, we should have at least about, you know, 180 million as a buffer, you know, to keep the fiscal position of the government floating into the future. And then next year it will increase incrementally. I mean, the whole rationale behind this is that you've got to invest into the future, and there are unforeseeable situations that can happen into the future, that if it happens, where will you tap into, you know, to help support delivery of services into the community. And so that principle, we have seen it working, and I am confident that, you know, we can have that as a way to have that, you know, reflected in the way that we are managing, you know, procedure out of our mining sector. Australia and New Zealand are so important to the region. They are what I call as the important connectivity to the international arena. We have the small economies in the Pacific that you can't just go directly into the international. You will sink. You will get sinked in the international arena. So you need that buffer, you know, to be able to build your capacity in dealing with issues of trade, for instance, or investment, assessing, you know, the sensitive issues that comes along with investment flows and capital flows from the international market into the small countries in the Pacific. So Australia and New Zealand, I think, plays that very important role. There are some leaders that think otherwise about that, purely from the political angle. I don't see it in that way. I don't see it that way. Now, coming to the sub-regional of the MSG, you will find that, you know, somehow the MSG, other countries that are, in a way, the only countries that have got good capacity to be able to generate good investment and economic growth, you know, within those countries because of the abundance of the natural resources that they have. There are other states in the Pacific that are basically welfare states. But in the MSG is not just a political body. I mean, it is a or political grouping. It is a grouping that shares a common issues with them in terms of the resources, the culture, and so forth. And I believe that if the MSG can be strengthened in that way, you know, they have the potential to provide a good prospect for economic opportunities to other countries in the region. That's how I see MSG. A lot of people see MSG as a way to diminish the powers of the four American countries and in a way to stage a contest on Australia and New Zealand. I don't think so. You will see that increasingly MSG have been able to meet and talk over issues of, for instance, you know, cultural heritage, resource management, skilled workers movement. These are all economic issues. They are non-political. It's all about building a strong economic base, which obviously, you know, it can be done through the bigger forum. It can be done through the bigger forum. But I think it can be better managed, you know, through that regional arrangement, sub-regional arrangement.
Clive, oh, I see.
Yes.
I'd like to ask you a question about the support of your government for a national university in the Solomons, and exactly what the reasoning is for it, and what the implications are for your, for instance, your relationship with USP. Will a USP campus, which has been promised for a long time, is it going to come, or will there be a close relationship between the new university and USP? And why at this stage is it important to have a national university?
As you know, that the biggest or the second biggest country feeding the USP is Solomon Islands. And I can understand why a lot of people are quite worried about, you know, Solomon Islands, you know, venturing into establishing their own national university. I think we need to see from the angle of an education system must be absolutely complete. You cannot have a country that has a half-done education system. If you have a population, you must feed it right to the end. That is exactly what Solomon Islands is trying to do. We have a good base in feeding up to the primary, elementary education, and that we cannot continue to have a system where we have to trim off people to fall off and then build up, you know, this unemployed group. We have to lead them up to better tertiary education path. I think you need to see it from that very simple fact. USP, I believe, can become an advanced or postgraduate, you know, education institution in the Pacific region. It's capable of doing that. They've already started doing that. They've expanded their infrastructure. They have got themselves into more specialized training program. And I think the emphasis in that regard would better prepare more postgraduate, you know, and advanced trained scholars out of the Pacific region into the international market. So in a way, I don't see it as a way of threatening the existence of USP. It will feed better candidates for higher education training at a postgraduate level. And if we better do, if we do it properly, you know, through, like, for instance, is what we are doing, Fiji is doing it, Samoa is doing it, in the Solomons we are doing it, I'm sure that we can have a better prospect of feeding the postgraduate market to be carried out by USP. But let's look at it in a way that, you know, this is a country of 500,000 people, 600,000. Well, we believe that we are around 600,000. We didn't quite make our census well recently. But if we had to look at a country that, you know, we need to build a strong society, a strong social, socially connected society, then the education system must be completed. We can't leave it an incomplete education system. It's simple as that.
In the back.
Well, I believe so, because as you know, that the only country in the Pacific that have actually enacted a protected areas legislation is Solomon Islands. There is a strong commitment to show that, you know, we are serious about protected areas, you know, and effective conservation program that are well, you know, attached to the local community. And it's good that, you know, we have live and learn people. I think I've met you before. But I would encourage you to work more closely with the community in building a strong community network in doing this conservation program, because that's what has actually failed in the past. That, you know, we tend to throw a design program of conservation to the communities and have not connected it to them being taking control of the ownership in the way that they will manage them.
One or two more, okay.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
Yes.
It will be quite a lot. I mean, right now, you know, you are looking at a mining that is, you know, if we get to settle some of the issues that we have with the local communities, we should be able to hit at least about 130,000 ounces per annum, you know, export capacity. But at the moment, we are just barely hitting about 80,000 ounces. But even at that level, you know, it is still a very feasible one, and one that we can look at in terms of holding a gap or filling in that gap that will be left if there's going to be a decline in logging over the next 3 years up to 2014-2015. At the same time, we have the nickel mining, you know, on Isabel and Choiseul, that will be 10 times bigger than the Gold Ridge mining. Now, the worrying thing is really managing the resources that will flow out of it. We have brought ourselves on a program to try to deal with the community, not buy them off, but engage them, put more infrastructure, connecting them to the market, build a more social structure and governance at the community level, that, so that, you know, they can take charge of their responsibility to manage issues connected with the mining development. So, social management issues, so to speak. But as you know, that there are challenges that are always associated with this, and some are domestically can be generated; others are externally generated. And most of the time, they've used the root of environmental issues, you know, to land their agenda. And this is one of the things that, you know, we are trying to get it right now, is to deal with the environmental issues so that we can deal with it in a more effective way by engaging all other parties and even getting the communities themselves and the investor to be able to agree on a better, transparent solution arrangement rather than a small problem, a bigger solution a machine to deal with. In the end, we disrupt everything. So that's the kind of approach that we are taking. Thank you.
One more question.
West Papuans are Melanesian, and they are very much in the heart of the MSG agenda. You cannot remove West Papua out of the MSG agenda. We will treat them just as important as the member countries themselves. We have done that so cautiously in the case of New Caledonia, and we believe that we will find a way to engage with other interested parties to be able to advance the cause of West Papua. I know that there are some very glaring reports that have come out about the human rights issues in West Papua. These are realities that, you know, we need to deal with. But I believe that the better connections that we have with Australia, and I'm pleased that, for instance, in this case where a prime minister from the Melanesian Spearhead Group has been given the honor to be a guest here in Canberra, will provide an opportunity for a one-to-one discussion with the leaders of Australia and New Zealand so that, you know, we can take at least a minimal step in addressing some of these human rights issues. In the field like yours, we will all want everything to be done. But in the field that I am in, we have to put them through, you know, some screening process, and that's exactly what I have to do. But it is still very much in the heart of Melanesian. On the Chinese influence into the region, I think they have a space in the region. We should not unnecessarily raise the alarm about the presence of Chinese in the region. They have been around, they will be around. They have shown what they are capable of doing in terms of resolving problems that are facing countries. Let us give them a chance. And that's exactly what Solomon is doing right now. We are opening up on trade and investment with China. Painful to the other Chinese that we are dealing with, but we are massaging them well because that is what it requires to be done. Don't ask me what that massaging means. I know how complicated it is to, you know, get such an explanation in this kind of an audience like this. But that's how far we can deal with it. Thank you.
Thank you.